Danny and Brinkley, on transformational consciousness. Consciousness. If we're going to evolve it, we must have some idea of it. If we're going to create a transformation of it, we have to have a way to relate to it. My part is eternal. So does that mean that consciousness is eternal? Or does that mean there's a certain part of consciousness that ends? Well, maybe a combination of both. I didn't contemplate my navel to become enlightened. I didn't study in great metaphysical schools in higher learning. Some people are enlightened. I was enlightened. So that's how I came to this brilliant, articulate, informative, psychological nature of my ability to understand and globally expand my conversation on consciousness as a theoretical application to reality. My near-death experience. While I was talking on the telephone, I was hit in the head by a bolt of lightning that went down my spine. It welded the nails in the heels of my shoes to the floor, threw me in the air, suspended me in the air, and threw me back and down on the bed. I was dead for 28 minutes. Completely paralyzed for 6 days, and partially paralyzed for 7 months. It took me 2 years to learn to walk and feed myself. One day I never believed a bit of this crap, the next day I was dead, and the day after that, I became everything I never believed. I come from South Carolina, everybody goes to hell where I come from. So by the time I was 6 or 7 years old, I had the deal down pat. So, I partied on. When we start looking at consciousness, you are more conscious when you are dead than you will ever be while you are alive. Consciousness does not even begin to be understood by you in your present state until after you've lived it. So programs like this come together to drive our hearts closer together, to think as one. And the one that we think of is that we can make a damn difference. It is inherent in the spiritual soul that single-handedly and alone you are capable of making a magnificent change. Who most influenced you? Who was there when you needed someone? Then that person is the uniqueness that evolves consciousness. Yours. And by you saying thanks, you evolve consciousness. Theirs. Consciousness and why we are here today. We have gathered as a society today. We're not an organization. We are a society. A group gathered with single thoughts in mind, to enter into a conversation, a rapport, an advancement of feelings toward one another. And that sense of consciousness is a feeling we have for one another. For one another, by one another, with one another's best hope and ideals put forth. It is eternal. When you start thinking about whatever, I want you to realize something. Forever is not near as long as you think it is. It's a lot longer, and you are going to be conscious of it for a long, long time. So this consciousness that we are trying to identify is being molded as we speak. Consciousness is an energy wave. Like a whale, swimming in the ocean. Speaking of whales, I'm consciously going to lose weight. I lost 11 pounds. I've been working at it. But consciousness is what you bathe in. Consciousness is the ocean, and you are a mighty creature that wails in it. That understands it. That moves in it. That has grace and eloquence in it. It's called the spiritual being, and as you start to realize that consciousness is around you, you are the molder and the creator of your reality. We have now learned in quantum dynamics and quantum physics that the observer has just as much effect on the end results of an experiment as the experiment's model, as it is created. We affect outcome. So we are the purveyors and molders of consciousness. Who understands what consciousness is? You woke up today. Were you unconscious until then? You were conscious. What consciousness is your ability to open your heart and take in the knowledge, the power that works through you. This earth was a conscious decision that was made in two parts. You were chosen to come here or you wouldn't have gotten here. I don't care what your mom and daddy did. You would not be here today if you were not chosen. And what does that mean? It means that the divine architect, the consciousness behind the consciousness, believes that there is absolutely no one better than you are at this moment to fill a certain place, a certain point, and a certain time in the evolution of spirituality, or you wouldn't be here. You are unique. So we always wonder what our mission is. Well, you have a divine mission, and whether you ever know what it is or not, who cares? Did you wake up today and are you alive? That means you are about what spirituality believes you to be. The best there is. Take a couple of numbers. In order for there to be someone exactly like you on the earth, well, the chances are 1 in 16 billion, and there are only 6,300,400,000,000 of us here. So guess what? You're the one. No one can do what you do to fulfill the divine promise of spirit unfolding in a physical plane better than you. You chose to come here because you believe you can make a difference. How did you choose to do that? By creating as many obstacles as you can possibly create. So you wonder how your life got so screwed up, you did it. Why? Because as a spiritual being you are a little arrogant. And the fact you are eternally conscious makes you responsible. Here comes the key to what consciousness is in our lives. We take the responsibility to open our hearts and collectively put our minds together to bring about what we feel to be the most wondrous environment for love to manifest itself. That's being conscious. So, when you created all these obstacles, you created an endless opportunity to figure out how to get out of them. Now if your life is like mine, about every 10 years I die just to kind of keep my perspective intact. My son Peter said, "Daddy, you've been dead 3 times. I said, "Hell, that's not near as important as having been alive before." One of the greatest transformations in consciousness is laughter. Because we open up our hearts and take deep breaths and our chakras spin and twirl and unfold. Consciousness is your ability to love. What you do with that ability becomes your responsibility to not only humankind, but to this earth, the mineral kingdom, the animal kingdom, and a few things that you don't like. Let me show you a massive shift in consciousness with a single two-word grouping, the Gulf region. A month ago, the Gulf region was Iran, Iraq, Israel, Palestine, Syria. A hurricane changed that. A hurricane understands spin better than the federal government understands spin. But the Gulf region is now us. It's now our animals, our friends, our children dying. It's not the Gulf region that split this country. It's the Gulf region that has united us. Because consciousness has a way of putting it in your face when it thinks you most need to pay attention to what you're not paying attention to. And that is unconsciousness. The place you never, ever want to be, never. Consciousness exists whether you exist or not. It exists whether you will be or not. Something that existed before you came into existence, and something that exists when you go out after existence, but that is never going to happen because you are going to always exist. Gloria Gaynor sang, "As long as I know how to love, I know I will survive. And as long as I know how to love, I know somewhere I will be alive. I have all my life to live and I have all my love to give and I'll survive." It got my attention. So now that consciousness is eternal, and consciousness is the vehicle that you are allowed to manifest, move, change and transcend the world around you. I believe that there is a fourfold path to this. How did I come to this? Struck by lightning, twice. Hey, guess what, Dan? We're going to kill you again. This is my relationship with spirituality. What it are me? Struck by lightning, talking on the telephone. 2 different bedrooms, 2 different houses, 8 miles apart, 3 years apart. 2 lightning strikes led to heart failure, which led to emergency open heart surgery, which led to my 2nd near-death experience, which led to a combination of me struck by lightning and open heart surgery, which led to me collapsing and going into cardiac arrest. I lived, but I had to have brain surgery. So, when you get struck by lightning, that's your spiritual self. When they cut the center of your heart out, we all know what I wasn't paying enough attention to. And when they try to take your brain from you, then they say, "Hey Dan, no, aren't you ever going to catch on? You teach best what you need to learn." People say, "Danian, what happened? What did you gain from all of this?" Well, I don't talk on the telephone. People say, "Danian, you're so special. You're so important." Hell, God called me on the telephone, and the only burning bush I saw was me. So how important can that be? When you take a good grip on consciousness and move it forward, you teach best what you best need to learn. It comes from adventures of a reluctant messiah. You teach what you most need to learn. Mine is not to be such a prick. I failed miserably at it on a daily basis. I try to be nice and I just never quite pull it off. I could get up from the dead with the theories I've calculated and populated years ago. What is consciousness and how do you explore it? The fourfold path. I can get up from the dead. From what I'm getting ready to prepare you for, the fourfold path. A lot of people talk. I can take those theories and get up from the dead. And I've done it 3 times in the last 55 years, against no chance to survive. None, but there's consciousness. Consciousness is your ability to understand that you are loved, that you are sacred, that you are precious, and that you are unique as a spiritual being. That's consciousness. How do you explore consciousness? The fourfold path. 1. Belief. What do you believe about you? Are you capable of loving and are you capable of being loved? What you believe about. That is how you begin to define reality for the universe. 2. Love. How do you see it? What is love? I'll use the Greek word. Eros, you all know which one that is. It's a communication of male and female, recreating a polarity that unifies the bonding nature of the power of consciousness, to love and be loved. Our friends, our relationships, the united grouping together. We love each other because we are friends seeking the way to make the world a more open place for love. There is only one global transformational problem. How do I provide a safer, more creative environment in which to give and receive love, and to teach it? Period. At the end of the game, there is no other purpose. There are little side tracks we can go on, like building rocket ships, drinking a little liquor, but there is no other purpose. 3. Choice. What choices do we make with free will? You chose to come here. What brought you here was your free will. Now, what's interesting about consciousness is that you can choose to believe it or not. You can do with it what you want. You can create it. The Cherokee have a saying, "Yesterday is only a memory and tomorrow is only a dream." So what you really have is now. Tomorrow will never come. It will always be today. To consciously love today creates tomorrow and restructures the past. That's our mission, to consciously love this day. To consciously love this moment, and that's a choice that we make. The evolution of consciousness is in our hands. It's not something external. It is the wavelets and movement as though we are in a vast ocean of love. Do we use it to propel us, to stagnate us, to brighten us, to control us, to be manipulated by it or to manipulate through it? That's the rest of the story 4. And then there is a system you use to propel consciousness. I use prayer. Prayer, willful conscious intent. I went through a science of study at Duke University, where they brought 300 scientists from all over the world to try to figure out how to create a research paradigm protocol to set up studies in prayer. The power of prayer. They came to define it as willful conscious intent. Now you think about it. Willful, a direct action by which it is that I choose to move forward. Conscious, that I am aware and present of the direct action that I'm taking. Intent. Intentionality is the driving factor of control that unites the universe. What is the reason? It's not what you do, it's why you do it. So the fourfold path, believe, love, choice, and the system that you use to propel it, the willful conscious intent is behind your actions. And once that happens, you become aware of consciousness as if you were it, that you were the creator of it. You are made in my image. He created man in his own image and blah, blah, blah. You become aware that you are the accuser of it to manifest good, bad, evil or whatever you want. After death, what's next? I stand before you and tell you that life is eternal. This is a small, very minute part of doorway. What you call life. It's 60 to 80 years at a pivotal point. Well, the first thing you're going to do when you take your last breath, you're going to lift up out of your body. You're going to enter this blue, great, wondrous place. You're going to look around. You're going to look back at your body, and the first thing that you're going to think is you will not be drinking with God anymore. Because you had to have been drunk to be stupid enough to get into that ugly blob of dead flesh to start with, and you had to be really drunk that day for God to talk you into it. And do you want to get back in it? Absolutely not. You will get a good grip on consciousness about what you don't want to do once you get out. Then you will pass through a tunnel and you'll come into a place with a bright, red, beautiful light. You're met by all your relatives and friends. Now, just to give you an idea of what kind of person I was, and kind of still am, I've been over there 3 times and no relatives even came to meet me. But you always think about it. When you get to the other side and you'll meet all your relatives and your friends, imagine a Nebraska dairy farmer and all those cows that come to meet him when he gets over there. And all the birds, and the chickens, and the cats, and the dogs. Whatever is love. However you identify, you know, how many pet rocks, a lot of people have Rubik cubes. A lot of people are going to see that a lot of people come and meet them on the other side, because it was their moment to escape. It was how they got out of abuse while their mother and father were beating the crap out of each other. They played that little cube. How many Barbie dolls, how many things, will be their representative to let you know true love matters, no matter what? I've got a big surprise for you, everybody. You have never left heaven. And then you're going to meet this being of light. This enormously powerful ray of light. Muhammad, Jesus, Allah, Krishna, oh, everybody's got a name for it. That beam of light that you're going to meet is you. You. That's who you meet. And you reunite with you. I've got a big surprise for you, everybody. You have never left heaven. You just focus your conscious intent into a physical body, in a physical form for a short period of time. The whole story about oneness is that you have never left heaven. You don't even know how to leave there. It is not possible to be able to do it. You think there's something outside of divine love. No, it's how you use it in the choices you make, in your belief system of your identity, of what you love and how you handle that process. It's still there. It's moving from our backs into our fronts, out of our mouths and our arms, and it uses us to manifest what I have decided to do with my life. Imagine how much we talk about death over here. Death this, death that. Oh, I'm afraid, blah, 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 blah. Well, I'm not afraid of death, I always laugh. What are they going to do, kill me? Big deal. Oh, hark, I'm so frightened. Death is silly to me. What I have decided to do with my life, after these experiences, is service, which this is about. Service. What did I just serve? My mission in life is to reduce the fear of death. Where can I do that? at the bedside. I'm a hospice volunteer. I've been a hospice volunteer for 27 years. I have had more than 17,000 hours at the bedside. And I have been with 353 people taking their last breaths on this earth. I understand death. I have died with more veterans than anybody on the earth. In the history of the United States, there has been no one single-handedly, as a volunteer, to die with more veterans than me. The Twilight Brigade. I created an organization, with the help of a few friends, called the Twilight Brigade, Compassion in Action. We are one of the largest end-of-life care volunteer programs for dying veterans in the history of the United States of America. Because of Georgia Lambert and the crap she starts. I told her last night I hate her. I told you I'd try to be nice, but it wasn't going to work. In my organization are people from Georgia Lambert's group that are some of the strongest, most dedicated human beings, spiritual beings, in human form, who stand up and face death, who train month after month, year after year, and run the empire. So, when consciousness is a call to action, make a choice today as you explore each and every one of us. Make a conscious choice in a belief system that creates an environment that you give more love to this world than you seek out. Those who have lost the identity of self-appreciation. It's the only way you will ever empower and enable yourself to use everything that you are being taught today. That you're doing it to figure out how to help somebody else. It's never about you, first. It will not work. The system fails to achieve the optimum level that it can possibly achieve, until it is for someone else. Because when you realize you are doing it for someone else, like, I want the world to be a better place. And everybody thinks they have left themselves out. Are you in the world?
Yes!
So, who are you really doing it for? You. You're really doing it for you. I want the world to not fear death. I want the world to embrace the next great adventure. I wish everybody could just have that 5 more minutes they wish they had with their loved ones, who they don't know they would ever see again. I believe I'm achieving it because we have nearly 6,000 praying, and we graduated 38 last week in Alabama who left the church, the Unity Church, and went out looking for veterans trapped in homes and nursing homes and their wives. This is consciousness. This is consciousness about love. There is no other form of consciousness. There is only ignoring the responsibility that comes with awareness. That we are aware. That means we are conscious. We are great, powerful, mighty spiritual beings with dignity, direction and purpose. So, let our consciousness this day, be that nothing is capable of taking that from us ever again. Nothing can ever take away that perspective of ourselves ever again. And all of a sudden, the transformation has begun because we are smart, we are patient. We are loving. Be a doer. We support, we hold, we embrace, we smile, we comfort. That's consciousness. That's awareness of consciousness, being a part of consciousness, and truly the makings of the identity of those who come after us. Those who walk beside us and those who look back at us. The Panoramic Life Review. How do I know this to be the absolute facts? The part of the near-death experience that I am most famous for is called the Panoramic Life Review. The great book of judgment, where all things are written. Everybody's got a name for it, every religion, and every mythology. I call it the Panoramic Life Review. So let me put this in your consciousness in closing. This will happen. You can deny it, you can hope it, you can unconsciously not think it, you can do whatever you want to do with it. It won't change crap. After you embrace that being of light, all of a sudden you see your entire life pass before you in a 360-degree panorama. You are impersonally looking at every single event like a holograph. You know how many hairs was in the nose of the doctor that pulled you from your mother. You know every label, every can, every doctor's name, every point. If you happen to look out of a window in the first couple of hours of your life, or when you're visiting your mom, you're going to know how many leaves are on any tree. If you think you're a know-it-all now, wait until you're dead. You will see your entire life pass before you. You will watch it from a second-person point of view, as if you were your best friend watching you. Celebrating your victories. Making fun of you when you're stupid, watching the dumb things you do. Like a parent watches a child, or like we watch a friend of ours going through troubled times, or drug addiction, or alcohol, or all the other things that addictions create, which is really lack of conscious knowledge of love. And then you will literally become every person that you've ever encountered. And you will feel the direct results of the interaction between you and that person. You are going to be every person. You are going to feel the direct results, good, bad or indifferent, happy, sad or joyful. Then the great book of judgment. Who judges you? You. But in a Danianism meaning of life. After you've gone through these three steps. If God couldn't come today so God sent you. In the life you just reviewed, what difference did you make? That will be your judgment. If the divine presence could not make its appearance today, she was getting her nails done. You know I am well trained. And the divine presence sent you, in the life you just reviewed, what difference did the divine presence make? I'm at the bedside. I walk into that room. This man or this woman is in the last hours of their life, and no one's come to see them in 10 years, and I'm there with them. God couldn't come today, so, I came. Why do I do it? Because I am smart. Because one day, my life will pass before me, and I'll get to feel the joy, the comfort, the contentment. The happiness at 2 in the morning that I brought that person, scared to death, afraid, who fought and served this country, had been in this country and left with no one. Go to see a vet today, conscious evolvers. Well, make it a point. Do you want to stop war? You want to transform war? You go to the bedside and listen to them. You go to the bedside and hold their hands. You go to the bedside and let them know they made a difference. And you will feel the presence of divine consciousness, and the divine presence you feel is your own damn self, and that is transformation and global consciousness. Thank you.